All right, it is 12 o'clock, so we'll go ahead and get started. I want to welcome everyone to Medical Grand Rounds at the University of Colorado. I am excited that we are back in person for Grand Rounds this year. I'm going to keep saying this for the first couple of these as different audience members log on from different departments and divisions. To remind people that we are live in Krugman Conference Room, which is in RC2 on the second floor. So really encouraging everyone to come to live Medical Grand Rounds this year. There is still the Zoom link. Their full credit is offered both in person and on Zoom. But if we can fill this room up, and we are about 95% full today, which is exciting. So if you're not here, you should be. It's a lot of fun. I want to also remind everyone that we've got a really exciting lineup for this year that's been published. It's online, so you can see that. In the near term, on August 17th, Dr. Manali Kamdar is going to speak about immunotherapy for lymphoma. And on August 24th, Dr. Amrit Amberdecker is going to talk about cardiac amyloid. So a couple, in addition to our speaker today, truly local experts. We're pleased once again to offer CME and mock credit. If you you can use the link that was sent out in your email, the one that Kelly Redard will put in the Zoom chat right now, or the one that's showing up on our screen. All Medical Grand Rounds are eligible for mock credit for our faculty. And I want to mention that questions will come primarily from our live audience, but I want to also make use of the Zoom chat feature. Our chief medical residents are here. They'll be monitoring the Zoom. Please use the Q&A feature if you want to put questions in there, and we'll use them for a conversation with Dr. Patel at the end of our talk today. So now I am pleased to welcome Dr. Swati Patel. She is an associate professor of medicine in the Division of Gastroenterology and Hepatology here at the University of Colorado. She is also the director for the Gastrointestinal Hereditary Cancer Center here at Colorado. She did her undergraduate work at Union College, where she graduated summa cum laude. She also received a master's in healthcare administration from the same university. She was then in medical school at Albany Medical College, where she was named AOA. And this theme of her receiving awards at every level continues when she was an intern and a resident in this program here. And we remember each other from a long time ago. She was the one of the recipients of the Gold Foundation Humanism and Excellence in Teaching Award when she was a resident here at Colorado. She also did her fellowship in gastroenterology here. We lost her for a couple of years to the University of Michigan, and then in 2015, we're lucky enough to recruit her back, and she's been with us full-time since then. She is truly a world expert in hereditary GI cancers and colorectal cancer. She's the author of 49 original manuscripts and counting on this and related topics. She has had easily twice as many speaking engagements locally, nationally, and internationally on the same topic. So truly a world-renowned expert. Her work has been continuously funded or near continuously funded since her fellowship. She is currently funded by 7 active grants, including what she is the PI, co-PI, or an investigator, including some local awards, VA national awards, and monies from both the NIH and the NCI. Her clinical and research interests are in improving and identifying individuals with hereditary cancer syndromes and early age onset colorectal cancer. She's the president of the Collaborative Group of the Americas on Inherited GI Cancers, a premier professional society dedicated to advancing research and clinical care for patients with hereditary GI cancer syndromes. She sits on the National Comprehensive Cancer Center Network Colorectal Cancer Screening Guideline Committee and is a member of the United States Multi-Society Task Force on Colorectal Cancer, where she recently led updating screening guidelines, supporting screening for 45 to 49-year-olds, which many of you are becoming familiar with. It truly is an honor to welcome you, Dr. Swati Patel.
Thank you, Dr. Connors. A very thorough and kind introduction. I'm really, really pleased to be here today, and thank you as well as Dr. Chopra for the invitation to talk about the rising tide of early age onset colon cancer and hopefully convince everyone that 45 is indeed the new 50, at least when it comes to colon cancer risk. So these are my disclosures, and I will mention, as Dr. Connors mentioned, that I do sit on some of the guideline panels that supported this recent change. So we'll start with a case. This is actually a very close friend of mine. This was several years ago, a 40-year-old at the time, healthy man, former firefighter, former Navy SEAL, and over the holiday season had been having rectal bleeding, bright red blood per rectum, painless hematochezia for about a month. He didn't share it with his family in the midst of the holidays, but ultimately told his wife, who insisted that he see his primary care doctor. His primary care doctor was able to see him very promptly, did an exam in the clinic, and documented that there were internal hemorrhoids with stigmata of bleeding. So he was counseled to take some topical ointments and advised to return if things didn't really improve. This patient, and really most importantly, his wife, was not all that pleased or content with that recommendation, and actually bypassed the PCP and self-referred for a colonoscopy. And this young, healthy, 40-year-old, physically fit man was unfortunately diagnosed with a stage 3B rectal cancer. So just think about this case as we talk today, and think about the family members, the friends, the patients that maybe you've had who have been diagnosed with colon cancer at a much younger age than we generally would expect. So in the time that we have today, we'll talk about the changing epidemiology of colon cancer with specific focus on what we're observing in younger populations. We'll talk about the clinical and pathologic features of colon cancer, specifically how younger patients present differently than older patients. We'll start to take a look at why we're observing changing trends and the possible etiology to the rising incidence in younger individuals and risk factors that we are starting to learn about. And then finally, we'll spend time talking about the practical approach to decreasing the burden of disease in this population and action that each and every one of us can take to decrease colon cancer in our younger patients. So thankfully, in large part due to wide-scale uptake of colon cancer screening in older patient populations, we have seen a steady decrease in the incidence of colon cancer in younger individuals. And this is the case when we break it down by colon site, by rectal site, and then combined as well. And these are plots that were generated by Dr. Eric Montminy, our GI therapeutics fellow, and we were able to use in our recent screening update. Unfortunately, we've seen at the same time over the last several decades, a steady rise in the incidence in patients diagnosed with rectal as well as colon cancer under the age of 50. This issue has gotten significant attention from everyone in our society, lay media outlets asking, why are young patients getting colon cancer? And in fact, many prominent members of our society, unfortunately, succumbing to this disease. So what do we understand about the epidemiology? Well, it's the second most common cancer in individuals under the age of 50 and the third leading cause of cancer-related death. There's been a 51% increase in incidence and an 11% increase in mortality over the last several decades. The vast majority of cases do in fact occur in individuals ages 40 to 49, and likely because of the paradoxic increase in screening in older individuals, the proportion of total colon cancers diagnosed in young individuals occupies a large piece of the pie, such that almost 30% of all rectal cancers are currently diagnosed in individuals under the age of 55. We know that incidence differs by race, and many may be familiar that the incidence rates are actually higher in Blacks when broken down by both distal as well as proximal colon cancers than whites. When we look at how these incidence rates have changed over time compared to the 1990s, the rates of proximal cancer in white individuals has increased, whereas surprisingly, the rates have actually decreased in Blacks. Both rates have increased for distal colon cancer among whites and Blacks. What's really interesting is that if we break down the subset of rectal cancer among whites is actually higher than among Blacks. And when we look at how that has changed over time, there's been a significantly higher rate of change among whites compared to Blacks. When we look at mortality, stage-specific mortality, unfortunately, is really quite significantly different when we look at race, with Black individuals having poorer survival compared to whites. When we look at how mortality has changed over time, thankfully, we have seen an improvement in survival among whites from the 1990s to more contemporary times, but there actually has not been a significant improvement in survival among other subgroups. These results hold even when we look and stratify results by patient sex, tumor site, as well as stage of diagnosis. Rates are increasing across our country, but as you can see from this heat map, the rates are the highest in our southern states and our Appalachian states. These changes start at the youngest ages and continue to split off as the population ages, with large differences seen regionally in our country based on the patient's location. Geographic changes are not as simple as macroscopic differences by region or state. It's a really interesting study looked at individuals diagnosed within rural counties compared to urban counties, and there was significantly higher incidence rates for individuals living in rural populations compared to those living in urban populations. This is an international phenomenon. You can see all of these countries where there's a red bar have shown significant increases in incidence in those diagnosed under the age of 50, whereas only a few bars where there's actually been a decrease in incidence with the blue bars. Many of these countries, as you will note, are Western nations or, such as Korea, recently westernizing nations. What's really interesting about this phenomenon is this concept that we refer to as a birth cohort effect. And this essentially is a concept that perhaps there's a generational exposure that increases risk, and that risk is carried out through the lifetime. So really what this plot demonstrates is that 20-year-olds who were born in the 1960s or 1970s have a significantly lower risk of colon cancer than 20-year-olds who were born in the 80s or 90s. And you can see that these inflection curves continue through each age group all the way through to 50 to 54-year-olds. Dr. Montminy published this recent paper that showed that stage is actually quite different when we compare the youngest patients diagnosed with colon cancer compared to those age 50 to 54, with 20 to 29-year-olds diagnosed with colon cancer much more likely to be diagnosed at regional or distant stages compared to 50 to 54-year-olds. So is this a different disease in young patients compared to old patients? Well, we have observations, and you have to take some of these observations with a grain of salt because many of these studies are pooled retrospective studies where factors are not necessarily controlled, such as the presence of a hereditary syndrome. But we start to note some observations that this disease entity might actually be different among younger patients compared to older patients. Young patients are much more likely to present with symptoms. Of course, they're not screen eligible. Unfortunately, young patients have a much more significant delay between the time of symptom onset and the time of diagnosis, with some patients being delayed as far out in certain studies as over 200 days. These patients that are diagnosed at a younger age are much more likely to have a family history. That seems intuitive. As we talked about, and as our case demonstrates, these individuals younger are much more likely to have a rectal cancer, have more aggressive histologic features, a kind of unique molecular subtype. They're more likely to be diagnosed at later stages, but paradoxically actually have better survival than those diagnosed over the age of 50. So why is this happening? Is this a different disease entity? Can we explain why we're seeing increasing rates in younger individuals? Well, this was a population as near population-based study as possible to try to understand at least the genetic basis of early age onset cancer. So this was a consortium of 51 hospitals across Ohio published by the Ohio State Group and Rachel Perlman. And individuals, regardless of family history, regardless of tumor characteristics, were offered multi-gene panel germline genetic testing. And what this group found was that, in fact, 16% of individuals had a pathogenic germline variant in a gene that's known to be associated with cancer risk. But that leaves us with 84% of individuals that had no specific identifiable genetic predisposition. We know that about a quarter of this pie has some familial components. So family history, not necessarily with a clear germline pathogenic variant. And what we understand about family history is that individuals who have a first degree family member diagnosed at any age have an over twofold increased risk of colon cancer. Those that have multiple first degree relatives or any single first degree relative diagnosed at a young age have an almost fourfold increased risk of colon cancer. Of course, as a gastroenterologist, I try to stay on the prevention side of this schema where we do colonoscopy, and our objective is not only to find colon cancer before patients develop symptoms, but to identify precancerous polyps. It's one of the most satisfying parts of my job to find lesions like this, remove them endoscopically, and essentially prevent the natural history to cancer. But as you may suspect, having an advanced precancer polyp and removing it doesn't necessarily change the underlying cause of that polyp and the impact that that may have on personal risk of future cancer and family history risk of cancer. And so not surprisingly, individuals who have a first-degree family member with an advanced polyp actually have the same risk of colon cancer as those with a first-degree family member with cancer. So what else could be contributing? We know that family history is a piece of this. This paper really summarized what we understand about risk factors for early age onset cancer. So these are risk factors specifically for cancer diagnosed in those under the age of 50. And as you see, there are some risk factors that track. These are risk factors that have been established in older populations, such as metabolic syndrome, sedentary lifestyles, excess smoking, processed or red meats, excess alcohol use. These are all risk factors that we know about in our older patients. Some of the more interesting risk factors were really ones that, if we start to think about how our society and our lifestyles and our exposures have changed, point towards potential generational exposures. So excess consumption of sugar beverages, a westernized diet were significantly associated with early age onset colon cancer. So when we start to think about why we're seeing these increasing rates in younger individuals, the epidemiologic observations, certainly the regional changes, the international observation, suggest that it may very well be associated with our known risk factors for colon cancer, obesity, diabetes, metabolic syndrome. That map could very well be a map of our obesity epidemic, given the overlay. But they also point towards perhaps some shared regional or environmental exposures, such as radiation. And then we also think about this birth cohort effect, where it appears there's generational exposure that patients carry over time, some of these novel risk factors that we've observed. And we start to think about how our society has been different for the millennial generation and younger. Exposure to childhood antibiotics in the food chain, industrialization of our food, and increasing inflammatory or atopic conditions start to raise hypotheses about early changes that impact cancer risk over the lifetime. And sometimes these exposures and changes are as early as in the prenatal or perinatal period and can then confer risk into adolescence and adulthood, for instance, changes in the microbiota. So what can we do about all of this? In some ways, it's overwhelming to think about exposures and risk factors 20 to 30 years ago that confer cancer risk now. Are there practical approaches that we can take to reducing the burden of disease for our patients, perhaps even for individuals in our social circles and our families? I guess before diving into what we do about this, it's important to take a moment and pause to ask the question of whether we should do anything at all. So I call your attention to the y-axis here and look at, although the direction of those curves is going in the wrong direction, you can see that the actual absolute incidence rates are orders of magnitude lower than the incidence rates observed in our older patients. So shouldn't we be focusing on our older patients? Even though the rates among 50-year-olds and older are going down, they're still, in absolute terms, significantly higher than the cancers diagnosed in younger patients. So should we focus our efforts on older individuals? Of course, I did declare my disclosures, and so you probably know where I stand on the issue, but I'll try to convince you as well. What's interesting, when we look at incidence rates now in 50-year-olds, in 45 to 49-year-olds in 2010, compared to the incidence rates of 50-year-olds in 1992, is that they're about the same. And so to provide some historical context for those in the room, 1992 is when we started to recommend colorectal cancer screening and when this was supported by our payers and our government payers. And so the incidence rates currently are about the same as they were for a population that we started recommending colon cancer screening back in the 90s. Similarly, multiple professional societies support screening among Black individuals, given the higher incidence rates that I showed you, the higher mortality at age 45. And what we're now observing, a paper published by Dr. Montminy showed that essentially the incidence rates that we're now observing among white individuals is now converging in the same for Black individuals, a population that we already recommend colorectal cancer screening for 45 to 49. The other thing I might point out is that a lot of this epidemiologic data from SEER, may very well underestimate the true cases of colon cancer out there in younger patients. This is oftentimes an asymptomatic disease. And you can see, I showed you this plot to show you the regional variations earlier, but there's a sharp rise in colon cancer rates from ages 49 to 50. And that's really likely because of a screening effect that asymptomatic individuals get their screening exams at age 50 and are diagnosed. So there's probably a significant proportion of subclinical diagnoses that we don't know about and are not reflected in those incidence rates that I have shown you. Furthermore, we know that younger individuals contribute significantly to our society. Younger individuals are oftentimes breadwinners, caregivers for their not only younger generations, but oftentimes older generations have significant contribution to society. And when this is quantified as person years of life lost, in fact, the person years life lost for 45 to 49 year olds diagnosed with colon cancer is actually approaching the person years life lost on a population basis to 65 to 69 year olds. So we have much to gain by focusing on this younger patient population as a society. So how can we actually do so? This is really the topic of a multi-day symposium. So I'll try to distill it down to, I think, things that all of us as internists can really focus on. So the first thing is really prompt evaluation of symptoms. And this was highlighted in the case that we reviewed. So we'll talk about that a little bit. My area of kind of very passion and interest is in recognition of hereditary syndrome patients. I invite you to come spend some time with us in our hereditary cancer center and spend time with us in our clinics. And we'd love to review that, but we'll put a pin in that for today's presentation. We'll talk about initiating screening earlier in high-risk patients, particularly those with family history. And then really the really hot button topic that we'll spend some time on are the recent changes in our guidelines to actually decrease the screening age from 50 to 45 and review some of that. So we know that prompt evaluation symptoms is very important. The data shows us this. There's unfortunately a significant delay in younger patients from time of symptom onset to diagnosis compared to older patients. And of course, this is likely multifactorial. Younger individuals may not have primary care doctors. They may be reticent to mention this to family members or their primary care doctors, as my friend was. But there's, of course, delays that we contribute to as medical professionals and the biases that we approach a young, healthy patient that we in our minds just want to always see as young and healthy. These are older studies, but I think highlight a very important point. In this study of about 200 patients under the age of 50 with scant hematochezia, bright red blood per rectum, almost 10% had some type of neoplastic lesion, precancerous polyp or cancer. In this study of approximately 60 patients where a primary care doctor evaluated the patient for bright red blood per rectum and was very confident based on the history and physical that there was a benign anorectal source, 18% actually had a more proximal rectal or colonic source. So I think this highlights an area where we can have a little bit more humility. We, of course, as internists want to rely on our history and our physical, but this is a scenario in which the presence of hemorrhoids, as such a common entity, can obscure pathology upstream. And so the history and physical, of course, are critically important, but please important to keep in mind that there could be other pathology going on. This recent study, this was a large cohort study, national VA data, really quantifies this for us. And what this study showed is that individuals with iron deficiency anemia and hematochezia essentially had an over tenfold increased risk of colorectal cancer. And so this really was adjusted and controlled for based on a variety of different other factors. And still, these two factors were significantly associated with colorectal cancer. Thus, our professional societies, this is a multi-society task force, recommends that lower endoscopy is indicated when there is not a sufficient explanation to determine the bleeding cause for individuals presenting with bleeding symptoms, whether that be hematochezia, unexplained iron deficiency anemia, or melena with an unexplained or negative upper endoscopy. This was a study that was published by one of our GI fellows who now is with Kaiser, but essentially surveyed primary care doctors in multiple settings, a safety net hospital, a large academic medical center, ambulatory sites associated with that academic medical center, as well as a VA hospital, and surveyed primary care providers from different specialties, internal medicine, family medicine, OBGYN, trainees, as well as independent practitioners, and asked individuals who respond to this survey how likely they were to refer a patient that was ages 40 to 49 with iron deficiency anemia for lower endoscopy. 78% or so said that most of the time or always, with significantly more saying sometimes. What about bright red blood per rectum? And again, this is for the 40 to 49 year old age group. And this is a little bit more concerning, where almost 54% were really the ones that showed, that demonstrated that they would most of the time or always refer for colonoscopy, whereas there was significantly higher proportion that said never, rarely, or sometimes. A little bit more of a distribution for those with changes in bowel patterns. So we have some ways to go in terms of getting the message out there that symptoms really should be taken seriously and unexplained symptoms should prompt a referral for further evaluation. What about family history? Well, we showed you that the rates of colon cancer, the risk of colon cancer is significantly higher with those who have a family history of cancer and advanced polyps. And it's no surprise that our professional societies recommend earlier screening, more intense surveillance, and to really recommend colonoscopy as the ideal screening modality in individuals who have a first degree family member with colon cancer. But what about those polyps that I told you about? Many people have likely in their primary care practice talked to patients who tell you that they have a family history of polyps. So this is a case that probably Dr. Fenimore sitting in the audience encounters on a weekly basis, where a patient comes in, establishing care, has presented to a primary care doctor because of slightly abnormal results, and mentions when a family history is taken that he thinks his brother, who just turned 50, had a polyp. Our follow-up question is always going to be, well, what kind of polyp? And I could probably count on one hand how many times a patient's able to tell us the specifics of that polyp. And the reality is the risk associated with this tiny 3-4 millimeter adenoma is substantially different than if the brother had this large lesion that required advanced endoscopic resection. But given the advances that we have in our GI practices, the patient experience is likely not significantly different. They come in for their colonoscopy, we tell them we took out a polyp and that it was possible precancer, and they go home the same day. And so there's an opportunity to really improve patient knowledge and physician communication of this. Our professional societies recognize the risk, and they actually do recommend intensive screening, just like we do intensive screening in patients who have colon cancer. But we don't do a very good job of communicating this risk to our patients. So this was a study including patients with these advanced polyps. So they clearly had an advanced polyp removed that was verified with their medical record, and they were surveyed about their knowledge. And what we found was quite concerning. Less than 30% were even aware that their polyp was precancerous. Only about 40% knew that their first degree relatives may be at increased risk of colon cancer. About the same proportion were aware that their first degree relatives are eligible for more intensive screening. And although as endoscopists, we were their top source of information about risk and surveillance recommendations, only 7% of endoscopists actually made any comment about risk to family members. So we have a huge opportunity to improve here. And it's entirely possible that this familial pie that I told you about that doesn't really take into account a family history of advanced polyps might actually be bigger than we realize. So then to spend the last kind of proportion of time that we have here to talk about this recent change, this recommendation to decrease the average risk screening age from 50 to 45, is that a possible viable way to really chip away at the rising incidence and burden in young patients? The guidelines really began this wave back in 2018 when the American Cancer Society put out a conditional recommendation to consider decreasing the screening age to 45. And after a lot of discussion, in 2021, our multiple other professional societies essentially followed suit, with the NCCN recommending for the first time decreasing the average risk screening age. The American College of Gastroenterology was shortly to follow. Our US Multi-Society Task Force, which represents our GI societies, followed thereafter. And then of course, incredibly important was that in May, the United States Preventive Services Task Force proposed decreasing the screening age. And this is of critical importance because, as we'll talk about, USPSTF guidelines, if there are grade A or grade B recommendations, dictate payer support. So what's at stake to now expand screening to the younger patient population? There's a lot of controversies and questions around this issue. Does it actually work? Does it impact incidence and mortality? If we start doing screening in younger individuals, what do we stand to find or gain? Will our primary care colleagues be accepting of expanding screening? Will patients be open to expanding screening? Will they actually show up for screening? Will there be payer coverage? Are the benefits actually going to outweigh the harms? I can't say that we have answers to all of these questions, but I'd like to at least start to present what we do know about some of these issues. Capacity, of course, being in the background of all of this, that even if we think all of this is worthwhile and helpful to our patients, can we actually do it as a medical profession? So what do we understand about yield? Well, there's more and more data coming out, but this is a nice systematic review meta-analysis that included only patients who were at average risk and who underwent screening colonoscopy under the age of 50. This was led by Dr. Jen Kolb, one of our GI fellows who now is at UCLA. And what she was able to find is that 45 to 49-year-olds overall had about 18% with any neoplasia, so any polyp, whether it's advanced or not, and about a 4% chance of having advanced polyp or cancer. And when we compared that to 50 to 59-year-olds, actually the yield of advanced colorectal neoplasia was the same in 45 to 49-year-olds as 50 to 59-year-olds, about 4%. So these are the lesions that are either cancer or those advanced precancer polyps, which are the targets of screening. And when we looked at the number of patients we would need to scope to find at least one of these advanced lesions, for 45 to 49-year-olds, it's 28 individuals, and for 50 to 59-year-olds, it's 24 individuals. We similarly looked at the rates of advanced neoplasia among the veteran population. Dr. Jack Scolaro, a graduate of this internal medicine program and one of our GI fellows, as well as Dr. Tim Yen, led this study, who graduated from our GI fellowship program. And again, we found that the rate of advanced colorectal polyps and cancer as a combined outcome was the same in 45 to 49-year-olds compared to 50 to 50-year-olds, 54-year-olds who are already eligible for screening. So the yield appears to be quite similar in 45 to 49-year-olds compared to patients who are already eligible for screening. Well, what about the harms, the costs versus the benefit? We generally rely on modeling studies, and this is the case for screening in older individuals too. Randomized controlled trials take a long time to complete. Many have been completing, many are still underway, but even for our older patient populations, to truly compare costs and benefits, we rely on modeling studies. And so the SysNet network essentially combines three simulation models. And what they did was compare screening outcomes, whether we started at age 45, 50, or 55. And what they found is that of the 57 strategies that were deemed to be efficient in this model, 47 actually recommended starting screening at 45. And put another way, it really, regardless of the modality that we use for screening, whether it's colonoscopy, CT colonography, flexible sigmoidoscopy, the stool-based tests such as fecal immunochemical testing, or the stool DNA testing, the benefits are clear across the board that starting screening at age 45 is superior than starting at age 50. Looking at it another way, for every 1,000 people that we screen, if we start at 45 instead of 50, we gain across modalities, life years, we prevent colon cancers and colon cancer deaths. And as expected, we do more testing, colonoscopy, as well as that first step test. And the complications are about the same across the board with slightly higher complications seen in colonoscopy. What about the cost? This was a cost effectiveness study published by Dr. Yuri Ladbaum out of Stanford. And really to summarize the take home from this, what they found was that if colonoscopy is the screening strategy that we select for 45 to 49-year-olds, that cost to our system would be about $34,000 per quality adjusted life year. If we were to choose a stool-based test, such as fecal immunochemical testing, which is equally supported by our professional societies, that would be about $8,000 per quality adjusted life year. All of these numbers in a vacuum aren't that helpful. especially if you're not familiar with quality adjusted life years and our kind of willingness to pay thresholds that are acceptable. But to give you a comparison to screening that we all accept, annual mammogram for 40 to 80 year old women is approximately $58,000 per quality adjusted life year. Even if we were to go with a less intensive breast screening program of mammogram starting at age 50 to 75 and only doing it every 2 years, that's $34,000 per quality adjusted life year to our society. So relatively speaking, expanding screening to the 45 to 49 year olds for colon cancer screening does not appear out of the realm of the costs for other screening approaches and really is completely dwarfed by treatment of late stage cancer. What about capacity? This is an absolutely real concern. This is US census data. And what you can see is that 45 to 49 year olds would add 21 million adults, like immediately add 21 million adults that would now be eligible for screening. Do we have the ability to actually take care of these individuals? Well, the same cost-effectiveness study estimated that if we did expand screening and if colonoscopy was our modality of choice, that would require almost 11 million additional colonoscopies per year over time. And this paper that looked at our colonoscopy capacity estimated that, well, gosh, it looks like we actually do have an additional available annual capacity of exactly that much, 11 million. But we all know it's not as simple as that. There's differences and disparities in access and whether patients can actually access the available procedures that we would need to do. When we look at our system, this data was pulled by our colleagues here at the University of Colorado when we were starting to look at this issue. And we found that really out of our kind of hospital system, that would be almost 150,000 45 to 49 year olds that are currently now eligible for colon cancer screening. Do we as a system have a capacity to accommodate this? And Dr. Fenimore, as our luminal section chief, has been contending with this challenge, especially for patients who are requesting access for colonoscopy. When we look at our VA system, we know that there's about 280,000 veterans across the country, ages 45 to 49. Well, guess what? We do about 282,000 colonoscopies per year as an entire VA system. And when we think about adding these 45 to 49 year olds to our capacity, that's 1.6 million colonoscopies for a system that does less than 300,000 a year. So certainly capacity is a very, very important issue. Will this strategy be accepted by our primary care colleagues, by our patients? Well, the same study that I reviewed with you by Dr. Parekh asked this exact question. Now, I will note that this survey was administered before the USPSTF guidelines were finalized, but after this issue has been in the public eye with the ACS guidelines in 2018. So it was administered back in 2020. But the majority of individuals were in support of screening individuals who have a family member with colon cancer, with 75% always recommending colonoscopy or colon cancer screening in patients with a first-degree relative diagnosed under the age of 60. But when asked about the general population of 45 to 49-year-olds with no family history, 93% indicated that they really wouldn't necessarily recommend colon cancer screening. This was predating the USPSTF guidelines. The good news is that we also asked what our primary care colleagues rely upon when they make such recommendations. And 90% really uniformly said that they rely on practice guidelines. So this actually is very encouraging that as practice guidelines change, practice changes. What about insurance coverage? Well, we talked about the USPSTF recommendation, which I think moves the needle forward quite a bit. This was a study that really doesn't surprise many, but a Kaiser Women's Health study asking about barriers to preventative services. And it's no surprise that insurance status and ability to pay is a significant barrier to seeking preventative services. And so that's why it is so important that the USPSTF put forth colon cancer screening for 45 to 49-year-olds as a grade B recommendation, because under the Affordable Care Act, that mandates that really payers cannot impose cost sharing. So it can't go towards a patient's deductible. They can't require copayment or coinsurance to get the colon cancer screening. a challenge that has been the case since 2010 when this law went into effect, whether it's for colon cancer in older individuals or younger, has been what we talk about as the donut hole. We talked about colonoscopy, and if that's the first test as a screening test, that's reasonable, but what if a patient chooses a stool-based test? And if that test is abnormal, does the follow-up colonoscopy really qualify as a screening test, or will insurance companies code this as a diagnostic test? And that really was a very, very challenging issue that we were running into. But thankfully, in January of just this year, the Biden administration essentially put out a clarification that defines screening as completion of a two-step screening test and really mandated that all payers by May of 2022 implement this into their programs. And so if you encounter patients who have fears about this, we can reassure them. We can oftentimes remind the insurance companies of this statement and get coverage for these services. So there's still a lot of questions around these issues and many, many more questions. How can we roll out screening in an equitable fashion? We know that there are disparities and structural racism that contribute to the differences, the epidemiologic differences that we observe. How can we roll out expansion of screening in an equitable fashion? What's the best test in younger individuals? Really, should we be recommending colonoscopy in all, or are there other tests that can be just as effective in impacting colon cancer incidence and mortality? Should we offer a menu of options like we currently offer, or a tiered approach for younger patients that then transitions to maybe a hybrid approach as they age? What about precision screening? Rather than a broad swath of recommending something for everyone, is there a way that we can actually select out the high-risk patients and ensure they get diagnostic or screening evaluation? Many, many questions, but the reality stands that multiple professional societies now support expanding screening to those 45 and older. But the reality is that even in ages 50 and older, we aren't doing a very good job. So in the state of Colorado, for 50 to 75-year-olds, we're still at under 70% for those that are eligible for colon cancer screening actually getting screened. What's even more disappointing is that when we break this data down by age, only about 50% of 50 to 54-year-olds are actually up to date with colon cancer screening. So we do have a long ways to go as we expand screening to continue efforts in our older patient population. But with that said, I think there's a few really interesting directions that that we'll see more and more data on. One is that we will likely have a more sophisticated approach to risk stratification of symptoms, precision screening, a lot of work being done in, for instance, polygenic risk scores, expansion of screening through population-based models. So rather than what we consider opportunistic screening, where a patient comes and sees you, asks for screening, a more population approach, to reach the audiences that we need, and then likely implementation of two-step screening programs, given the capacity issues that we are realistically dealing with in terms of colonoscopy. So with that said, and before we open the floor for discussion and questions, we know that early age onset cancer is on the rise. Some of the epidemiologic and clinical observations, pathologic observations, start to give us clues as to why this is happening, what's different about our exposures that's leading to these rising rates. But nonetheless, this really increase in disease burden demands our immediate attention. And the lowest hanging fruit that all of us can really focus on in this room is ensuring patients who have a family history of cancer, a family history of advanced polyps are referred for screening, and those who have symptoms are thoroughly evaluated. And of course, ongoing work will need to be dedicated to ensuring equitable access if we are to continue efforts at expanding screening. And that's equitable access across all age groups. So if this is a topic that is of interest to you, I invite you to email me. There's a symposium actually that will take place in Milan in September, but it's also virtual and it's free. Registrations. This is a multi-day symposium that really kind of dives into a lot of the issues that we did a broad overview of today with an international perspective, which I think is always nice. I also would call your attention to the fourth annual Dennis J. Onan Lectureship. Dr. Onan was a champion for colon cancer prevention and really even posthumously dedicates his kind of legacy to educating all of us about colon cancer prevention. So September 19th and 20th, save the date. We'll have more information forthcoming from the DOM, but please tune in. These are talks that are very, very interesting and relevant to all of us. And then finally, if the hereditary GI cancer syndrome pieces are of interest to you, I invite you to join us in Nashville at our annual meeting, where you will get more information on hereditary GI cancer than you ever thought was interesting. Thank you for your attention.
Patel, thank you very much. That was expert talk in all content and delivery. Thank you very much. I'm going to throw it open for questions
to the audience right now. I'll start with Dr. Chopra.
Dr. Patel, thank you. That was incredible. I think you've got me convinced 45 is the new 50. I turn 45 next year, and I certainly hope our capacity problems will be solved by then.
For you specifically, we'll solve it.
I do not want special treatment. My question is around, you talked about disparities a little bit, and we know that African Americans have later diagnosis, worsened outcomes when they're screened currently under the 50 or the prior 50-year-old paradigm. Has there been any type of sort of thought around, gee, if we do move this up to 45 and we're already not able to meet sort of that particular subset of the population, could we worsen disparities and actually make this a little bit worse?
Thank you for that question. That's been of keen interest. Even as these conversations were starting well before the guidelines changed, one of the most concerning potential impacts was that it would just widen disparities, especially in the US system where we do opportunistic screening, right? So when we think about screening models, there are countries like the UK that just send every single person who's eligible a stool fit kit. On the other hand, in the United States, we have opportunistic screening where the individuals who have access to medical care, who have the time to discuss colon cancer screening and are proactive about it, are the ones who are offered screening. And so this has been of significant concern and interest, and there are concerted efforts at multiple levels to customize educational campaigns, navigation campaigns. And a lot of that really starts not only with medical professionals dedicated to this, but community engagement organizations, patient advocacy organizations. Fight CRC is at the forefront of really advocating and getting the message out there. But I think it's a challenge that we'll continue to face. And my general sense is that we will continue to battle that until there's a more structural, systematic, population-based approach to screening, which large systems like the University of Colorado, like the VA, like Kaiser can move towards, but is a challenge in general in the United States if we don't take a population-based approach.
Dr. Fenimore.
That was phenomenal, as always. I guess two questions that I wanted to ask you, and they're unrelated. But the first one was, with these earlier rectal cancers in younger patients, have you guys looked at the genetics, and does it follow a different genetic pathway to develop with different genetic changes earlier on? The second, I'll let you answer that question first.
Dr. Fenimore knows I can only process so much at a time. So thank you for pausing after asking the first question. That's a great question. As I mentioned, the molecular subtype of early age onset cancers appears to be different than cancers diagnosed in older individuals. And actually, Chris Liu published a lot of that data and really put kind of very landmark work out there. Some of those questions are not entirely answered completely yet, but it does appear that patients progress through a different molecular pathway. And so we think about, CPG island method or SIMP pathway, the MSI high pathway. And it appears that early age onset cancers have what's called line hypomethylation. I know it's very, very riveting for most in the audience, but it looks different than later age onset cancers. The reality is that studies haven't quite teased out whether that's a feature of rectal cancer alone or overall early age onset cancer compared to later age onset cancer.
Great. And the second question I had relates to capacity. And you touched on this a bit, and you and I have talked about this a lot. I've seen in multiple talks of yours that FIT is really a great screening test. And I wanted to get your thoughts on doing a tiered system where we offer maybe FIT earlier on. And are there pitfalls that I'm not appreciating that might get us in trouble in having that tiered system?
the best screening test is the test that can get done. And that's something that Sid Winauer said, that Dennis Onan, you know, was really very much emphasizing. As we face capacity issues, I think a systematic approach with something like stool-based testing is a really, really, really good idea. Because when we talk about the outcomes of interest, colon cancer incidence and mortality, you know, and whether that's a system like the University of Colorado or nationwide, it comes down to who's actually able to get the test. So I didn't present this data, but there was a recent study that really, two things, showed that patients who were offered colonoscopy had a much lower adherence rate than those who were offered colonoscopy, but if colonoscopy they didn't want fit, so kind of a tiered approach, or a choice where they could just choose which one they wanted. There was much higher adherence in the patients who had kind of that sequential offer or a choice offer. The second thing was that this study showed is that the rates of advanced colorectal neoplasia that they found on that round of screening was the same between all three modalities. So even though we think of colonoscopy as the gold standard test, it depends on how many patients are actually able to get it. And so I think, you know, to really cast the net widely and do stool-based screening for a wide population of individuals culls out and kind of saturates the patients that are referred for colonoscopy and ultimately may yield the same rates of neoplasia and cancer prevention benefit. Do we know which test is best? Actually, no. There have been no randomized controlled trials published that actually compare fit to colonoscopy. There's multiple ones that are underway, including the CONFIRM study that many may be familiar with. 50,000 veterans that were randomized to fit annually versus colonoscopy, and the outcome of interest is 10-year mortality with colon cancer. And there's actually hypotheses that there may not actually be a significant difference between the groups because of these issues of adherence. Now, speaking to an internal medicine primary care audience, navigation for an annual screening program is a real significant burden. When we do colonoscopy, we do it once. Based on what we find, we make recommendations for repeating a test in 10 years, 7 years, 5 years, 3 years. FIT is an annual test. If it's positive, it requires a follow-up colonoscopy. We all know how fast life goes by, and before we know it, a year has gone by. And so that's a substantial burden on primary care to keep track of another annual test that has to be done. And so I think for that to be successful, particularly in a system, we need support, navigation support, to make sure it's sent out to the entire population, to make sure those kits are sent back, navigation support for specific subgroups where we know that the return rates are lower, and focus on those groups to make phone calls, send MHC messages to get those kits back, and then actually trigger the colonoscopy for tests that are positive. And that burden can't fall completely on our primary care colleagues. And I'm not just saying that because my primary care doctor is in the audience.
I think there's some online questions, but I want to ask one while we're gathering those questions together is, maybe I'll push this ahead even further. What do we know about screening even younger patients, right? Do we think this is an inflection point, 45 to 49, or could there be value to going down even further?
I think it's a philosophical question. The data is what I presented to you, and the value judgment as a society is where we draw the line. I'll answer that question by sharing with you that the Europeans are showing the same data, the same trends, and yet they have not decreased the screening age because on a societal level, they've looked at all of this and had to make calculations based on, you know, their capacity and resources. And so I think, you know, it's one of those issues that certainly we could go lower and lower and lower, but it's a matter of us deciding kind of the cost and the benefit and where the burden is the most, where we can actually impact some of those cost benefit issues. I think in the younger patients, the key message is that the first time you meet a patient is the time to think about colon cancer risk, no matter how young or old they are. So really quick questions about colorectal cancer risk in the family and polyps. So give the patient homework. Your dad had polyps. Next time I see you, I need a screenshot or a picture of what type of polyp they had, what it looked like under the microscope. And then symptoms, no matter how young or old a patient is, to really go through those red flag symptoms of hematochezia, bleeding, iron deficiency, and send those patients for referral. I think those are the key things in the patients under the age of 45.
Thank you very much. We have a few online questions, a lot with the similar themes to Dr. Chopra and Dr. Fenimore. So hopefully your questions were answered with that. But kind of expanding on this idea of access and capacity, can you comment on patient-directed open access scheduling rather than clinician-ordered studies as a system approach to improving our screening rates, in particular fit to colonoscopy if it's a triggered positive?
Yeah, I think it's an outstanding idea for the stool-based test because that test is something that can come with instructions and is low or no risk. Collection of a stool kit, mailing it back to us. I think the issue becomes a little bit more complex when you have to wear Dr. Fenimore's hat, who's sitting behind you, where he runs a GI lab. And it comes down to all of the very specific things that he makes sure happens to make sure a patient gets a safe and effective colonoscopy. So how many people in the room have had a colonoscopy? Okay. So many of you have not, but it requires a lot of preparation, you know, instructions on the bowel preparation. We administer anesthesia. And so although that's safe and well-tolerated for most patients, we need an understanding of medical comorbidities and whether there's any specific ways that we do the colonoscopy so it's safe. Comorbidities or medications that change how we do the procedure, whether we can do it safely. So antithrombotics and anticoagulation. So although it'd be great for us to just open access, allow patients to slot themselves in for colonoscopy, I'm afraid it wouldn't be the safest and most effective thing for patients. It does require us to very carefully look at the entire patient profile to make sure we set it up in a safe way and make sure it's effective. We want them to show up with a good bowel preparation so we can actually give them a good clean bill of health.
And Dr. Fried was asking on the opposite end of the age spectrum about the upper age limit for colonoscopy screening where risk exceeds benefits.
That's an excellent question. So we've been focusing on one end of the curve. When is it okay to stop? Well, the great news is that colonoscopy is very effective. A high quality procedure, meaning complete to the cecum with a good quality bowel prep and performed by a high performer like Dr. Fenimore, is protective of colon cancer for 17 years. Okay, 17 years is the protection benefit we get from a negative colonoscopy. So this is important information to share with your older patients, especially for patients who have been on schedule and have negative multiple consecutive exams. If you are speaking with a patient in your clinic in their 70s, this is important data. And they may very well say, I'm not sure where life's going to take me in 17 years, but you know, with what you're describing to me and the information that you reviewed with me about my recent colonoscopy, I'm okay with not proceeding. And that's what our professional societies essentially recommend, is to initiate this conversation about potentially stopping screening for those who've had negative consecutive exams starting at the age of 70. And they actually recommend against continued screening after age 75 to 85. Now that's screening. So that means asymptomatic and they've had negative exams in the past. For patients at that age who've never had screening before, that's a different story. We don't know what their colon holds. And so that's sort of a shared decision based on their ability to tolerate the procedure, but we would certainly recommend it. And it's totally different than surveillance, which is exams to follow up on patients who've had polyps in the past. And then again, completely different from patients where it's a diagnostic exam. So symptoms, or abnormal lab tests or abnormal imaging. But for straight up screening, it's very worthwhile to start talking about de-escalating screening at around 70 and certainly after 75, just because of how effective we know good quality negative colonoscopy is.
I don't see any other audience questions. I think we just have 1 minute left and I'll just ask you a question about you. How did you go from intern, resident in this program? There's so many house staff here and fellows, to a world's leading cancer expert?
It was a circuitous path. And in 1 minute, if I were to distill it down, it would be my mentors. I mentioned Dr. Onan a few times. I've had many mentors within this department, our GI division, as well as at the University of Michigan. And it was really with their guidance and sort of their sponsorship of opening doors for me that got me passionate about this issue, got me active on a national level, but it comes down to mentors if I answer that question in a minute.
I think it was perfect. Thank you so much for your talk.